Bonito. So I'm not an organic person, so I'm not drawing very nicely structures, but you will understand. So you have, so this is equivalent to, so you can see there are two hydrogens here. One hydrogen is here, one hydrogen is here, and this is a sulfonic group, or it is SO3 H. So basically you have three protons, so it has one strong sulfonic acid proton and two weak phenolic protons. So in general it is represented as H2In negative, right? So it has strong sulfonic acid proton and two weak.
And what does H2In minus means?
In is indicator.
Okay.
As a whole, and H2, that means two protons are still available. So whenever you react this, the whole complex, this agent with metal ion is going to displace another proton from it, and as a result you have different color of metal ion complex and your proton is released. So IN stands for indicator, I'll write it down.
And all the indicator are represented like this, also ma'am.
Yes.
Okay.
So it has one strong sulfonic acid proton and two weak phenolic protons, which can be replaced by a metal ion. Do you remember about auxiliary agent? Just now we talked about why do we add the buffer to this solution? I keep on asking because so that you don't have to mug up everything. If you understand, you can write on your own also. Why do we add buffer to the solution whenever you are doing EDTA titration? Any answers?
To maintain the pH of the solution.
Yes, can you repeat?
To maintain the pH of the solution.
So why do we maintain? What is the reason behind that?
So that it will not make the PPT. It will not make the PPT precipitate, ma'am.
That is one thing. Other thing is that because your particular EDTA species, have you seen that different types of EDTA species? I have also shown you the fraction of EDTA as a function of pH, right? So we maintain a particular species in highest concentration in predominant form at a particular pH. So as a result, only that EDTA species is going to combine with your metal ion. So usually we work with 10.2 pH. Just a minute. So Nisha, try to join the class in time from next class. So I don't want to tell each and every student about joining the class in time. You should understand why I'm saying this. So, for example, if you have H2In negative, this is the indicator, metal ion indicator, it has capability of losing one more proton, and this becomes HIN, this becomes not too negative, and this color is blue. Now, if this again loses one proton, this becomes IN how much So this is going to become IN
minus 3.
T minus, ma'am.
So the color is this orange. So if I take the example of zinc, for example, if I take zinc metal ion 2 plus, plus I take H IN 2 negative, this is going to become H, sorry, Zn IN negative plus H plus. So this is having red color. So if you look at the color change to red, I mean, this is one of the titration, so that indicates the end point. So again, the condition is that these indicators must bind metal ions less strongly than EDTA does. That is important criteria for these metal ion indicators. These indicators must bind metal ion less strongly than EDTA does. That means the conditional formation constant of metal EDTA complex should be higher than metal indicator complex. Otherwise, your EDTA would not be able to displace the indicator. I mean, this theory is applying everywhere, wherever you study different types of EDTA techniques, like how we are going to titrate. So this concept is applicable almost everywhere. So now I'll take another example. Let us take magnesium ion. So this reacts with, for example, this reacts with an indicator. In general, I am writing. And here you take EBT as the indicator, this EBT. So it is going to make complex MgIn, and the color is red. So now if you add EDTA now to this complex solution, now you're going to have magnesium EDTA plus indicator. So this indicator is now free in solution, and this is blue in color. This becomes colorless. EDTA is colorless in the beginning, and this is red. Here I have written it is red. So it depends upon, it's colorless. So when you add this EDTA, it is going to displace this indicator from the metal ion, and it's going to react with EDTA. Now this complex becomes colorless, and this indicator is free in the solution, and it is blue in color. So this indicates the endpoint. So you have other indicators of similar structure. These are available for a variety of metal complex determinations. So I'm going to give you some of the examples other than EDTA, this EBT. So you have other indicators. I mean, one example with structure is sufficient. You don't have to give structures of all other. Variety of for example, EBT. This is the famous example. This is used for the detection of different metal ions such as barium, calcium, cadmium, magnesium and zinc. So these is calmagite. This is used for same metal ions as above. Then the other example is murexite. This is used for the detection of copper, cobalt, and nickel. Another example is pyrocatechol. We have it for aluminium, bismuth. We have calcium and ytterbium, iron and manganese. So these are the metal ions which we can use for the determination using these metal ion indicators. So each indicator needs a particular set of conditions for a specific metal ion. So I write this point here. Needs a particular set. I don't know those who are using their mobiles for the classes. I don't know they are able to understand or they are able to understand this font size, because I mean if you are using laptop that is fine, but if you are using mobile phones this font size is I think smaller. So each indicator needs a particular, so it's better after the classes you go through the notes so that you will understand and listen carefully whatever I'm telling you. So we talked about, this is a sort of direct titration, isn't it? So we talked about direct titration with a visual indicator, right? However, there are several other alternative methods for the determination of nearly every metal ion. So this is one type of EDT titration, which is a direct titration. So now we are going to talk about 5 or 6 important applications or scope of EDT applications. This is very relevant from the exam point of view, and one question out of this is, I mean, most probably this will come in your exam. So listen carefully, and in the next class, whenever I start, I'm going to revise whatever I have taught in today's class, so that you are in regular touch whatever I'm teaching you. So it doesn't appear that you are learning something new. बहुत सारे स्टूडेंट्स क्लास भी नहीं करते हैं, फॉर देम ऑल्सो इट इज बेनिफिशियल. सो स्कोप ऑफ ईडीटीए एप्लीकेशंस, सो एज आई टोल्ड यू टिल नाउ वी टॉक्ड अबाउट डायरेक्ट टाइट्रेशंस यूजिंग अ विजुअल इंडिकेटर विच इज अ मेटल आयन इंडिकेटर सच एज ईडीटी. सो आई टोल्ड यू हाउएवर देर आर सम अदर अल्टरनेटिव मेथड्स for the determination of nearly every metal ion. So first we'll start with direct titration. So we'll summarize very quickly here. First is direct titration. So here what we take the analyte or metal ion. So here you take analyte, the ion which you need to detect, right, is known as analyte or the concentration of a particular ion which you wanted to actually measure is your analyte. So I have used this new word, analyte or metal ion. Both are same thing. Metal ion is titrated the standard solution. We already talked about what do you mean by a standard solution. So how do you know a solution is standard or not? For example, you are going to prepare a known concentration of EDTA solution. You're not sure about its whether it is standard or not, then you need to standardize this using another reagent. You have to titrate this EDTA with known standard solution. So once you titrate this, now you know the exact concentration of this EDTA. Now you can say that your EDTA is a standard solution. Usually in practicals, you make standard solutions of EDTA, or sometimes you are provided with rough concentration of something, maybe N by 50 or something, and you're asked to standardize this. For this, you have to prepare the own solution, because right from the scratch, for example, you have some salt, you weigh it, right? You transfer it into volumetric flask, you prepare the standard solution, and you should calculate how much exact amount of salt you have transferred. So everything you are going to do, and then now you have a standard solution, you are going to titrate this with EDTA to know the exact concentration of EDTA. Now you can use this EDTA for the determination of the analyte or the metal ion. So in direct titration, you take the metal ion and titrate it with the EDTA. So usually this analyte is buffered to a pH at which the formation constant for metal EDTA complex is large. So you have to titrate in such a way, first thing you have to add buffer, and you buffer the solution and you fix the pH of the solution, and you have to make sure that the conditional formation constant for metal EDTA complex is large. These values, you can find it in the literature. I have also shown you one table in which you have formation constant values at different temperatures. So this will help you whether, for example, you have zinc at one side, other you have calcium or magnesium. So when these metal ions are going to bind with EDTA, so what is the formation constant? Is the bond is going to be stable, this coordinate covalent bond? So this you can understand with the value of conditional formation constant. So your analyte is buffered to a pH at which Kf dash for metal EDTA complex is large. Okay. And the color of the indicator is distinctly different. This we talked about, the color of the indicator is distinctly different from that of the metal indicator complex. So what do you do to maintain the pH of the solution and to prevent the hydroxide formation if you are working in basic medium? So you add auxiliary complexing agent. Make sure that you write the correct spelling. It is auxiliary complexing agent. For example, you can add ammonia, you can add tartrate. These are the examples of some auxiliary complexing agents. and you have citrate, tetraethanolamine. Maybe I'll write it. These are the examples of auxiliary complexing agents, and these actually prevent metal ion from precipitating in the absence of EGT. This we can understand with an example. So you have lead metal ion. This reacts with ammonia buffer, which is an auxiliary complexing agent. Here you have used this as a buffer, and you can also use tartarate also. This is to fix the pH. And you have lead tartarate complex, and this does not allow lead hydroxide to precipitate in the absence of. Now you can add EDTA in the next step. When you add EDTA, you have this tartrate is replaced by EDTA. You have lead tartrate now. You add EDTA to the solution, so now you have lead EDTA complex plus tartrate, and this is actually going to prevent the metal ion from precipitating, because it has already protected this metal ion. This tartrate has protected this metal ion to prevent the precipitation of lead in the form of hydroxide when you have not added EDTA. So here again, the conditional formation constant, so kef should be here, the conditional formation constant of lead tartrate complex should be lower than lead EDTA complex. ये समझ आ गया सबको?
मैम, यस मैम.
ओके, वेरी गुड.
व्हेन विल वी ऐड मेटल आयन इंडिकेटर देन?
यस
मैम, व्हेन आर वी एडिंग देन इंडिकेटर हियर? Because we are forming,
you can add it right now also in the very beginning. So these are auxiliary agent, so you have to take care the formation constant of metal indicator, metal auxiliary complex and metal EDTA. So depending upon the values it is going to displace.
Okay. Then lead will get attached to indicator, na? Then why are we adding tartrate to get it attached?
Tartrate, I know, is an auxiliary complexing agent. Because in the absence of this, if you are using the alkaline solution, it is going to precipitate out your metal ion. Just to protect this metal ion. That's why I have added tartrate, and ammonia buffer I have added just to fix the pH. And now you can add the indicator, right? So indicator. A metal complex is stronger than this metal tartrate complex. So indicator is going to displace this tartrate, right? So now your metal ion is protected, and now it has reacted with your indicator. Now once you start adding EDTA, the EDTA is going to displace the indicator. This is just to explain you like how you are protecting your metal ion from precipitating out into the solution. That is the role of auxiliary complexing agent. Nothing more than that. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, that's good. So we can cover one more topic very quickly. The second is indirect or back titration. So right now we were discussing about direct iteration, and we added a visual indicator. We also added auxiliary complex knee agent to prevent its hydroxide formation, and then we titrated with EDTA, standard solution of EDTA. So that was a direct method. The indirect method or back titration, can anybody tell me why we use back titration or indirect titration? Why we go for this? Why can't we do direct titration every time? So sometimes it is not possible to directly titrate your metal ion with EDTA, standard solution of EDTA. We need to do this back titration. For example, if your metal ion precipitates in the absence of EDTA, that is one example in which you need to go for back titration. The second example is the reason, I mean, more appropriately, you can say it's the second reason is that your metal ion reacts too slowly under titration conditions. I mean, the rate of reaction is very, very low. It is taking too much time, metal ion, to react with the EDTA. So in that case also, you need to go for back titration. So we'll see what a back titration is. And the third reason could be your metal ion is blocked by the indicator. So if your metal ion is being blocked by the indicator and this EDTA is not able to displace this indicator from the metal ion, in all these cases, you need to go for back titration. So let me summarize these points. So why do we go for this back titration? So the first reason, आप लोग आज प्रैक्टिकल है क्या?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So you have practicals on Saturday, Friday and Saturday, is it?
And Monday. Friday, Saturday, Monday.
Monday also.
Okay. So these are the conditions in which you undergo back titration method. So there are certain metal ions such as chromium, dustrine, ferric ion, aluminium ion, titanium ion.
Ma'am, how metal ion blocks the indicator, ma'am? What does mean?
That means the metal is metal indicator bond is much stronger than metal EDTA complex. ठीक है? Block कर दे रहा है, so it is not allowing EDTA to come in and bind with your metal ion. So there are certain metal ions, I told you some examples like aluminium ion, ferric ion, titanium ions. These react very slowly with EDTA and the titration time is very high, inconveniently very long. So for example, in order to carry out such reactions, you might have to elevate the temperature as well. So that is a problem because the rate of reaction is very, very low. For example, your ferric ion, chromium plus three ions. So this you can, overcome by adding excess of EDTA. If you add excess of EDTA, followed, basically, we are going to see how you are going to do back titration. So now you know the reason why we wanted to go for back titration. And we know some of the examples which react with EDTA very slowly, and this is going to take inconveniently very long time, and in fact sometimes it requires high temperature to carry out a particular reaction. So in that case we need to go for back titration. So what we do to the same reaction mixture, we add excess EDTA. ठीक है, तो जितना EDTA react करना है react कर जाएगा. The excess which is left, right, is then back titrated with a standard solution of second metal ion. So पढ़ा है कभी back titration? Yes or no?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
So you might be going for this back titration during practical exams also, I think. I'm not taking your practical classes, but you'll be doing that for sure. So you have medals. Do we have time? Okay, we have like 10 minutes. So are you all comfortable in listening to this electronic board, or like I have already, I mean, the slides are ready and then I teach. Which one is easier to understand? Or both?
And this is easier.
Yes, ma'am, this one.
Okay. I mean, in this case, I don't go very fast, because I write each and everything and explain you like a blackboard. So I think this is more convenient to you. So we'll stick to it, unless, I mean, if I don't have much time at the end, then I can show you up all the slides quickly and I'll cover the syllabus. But in the very beginning, we'll go like this only, so that you understand each and every step. This is, this mode is, I think, better. It is more or like, more or less like an offline class. I mean, we do not have interaction much. We cannot see each other, but it's not a problem. So the safety is better at this moment. So you should join offline practicals and you can come for theory classes. That is not a problem. So metals such as chromium 3 plus, we have Fe3 plus. These react very slowly, but this of course takes more time, because I take time in writing and the titrations. So such type of metal ions, such metal ions can be titrated by adding excess EDTA followed by So what do you do in a back titration? You add a known excess of EDTA to the NLI. And the excess EDTA you added, you know how much extra you added. So that excess EDTA is titrated with the standard solution of a other metal ion, which is a second metal ion. And the second metal ion used in back titration must not displace the analyte metal ion from EDTA complex. ये बात समझ आई नहीं आई? Did you get my point? So when your reaction is very slow, in that case, you might have to elevate the temperature as well. So in that cases, you have to add excess EDTA. So now, when you add known volume of excess EDTA, that known volume of excess EDTA is then again titrated with standard solution of second metal ion. And the formation constant of this second metal ion with EDTA should be less, right, than formation constant of your analyte metal ion with EDTA. So this is how you do the back titration. So this is not very tough. You should understand that we have a metal ion which is not able to, I mean, it is taking too much time to react. In that case, a known volume of excess EDTA. This known volume of excess EDTA is then titrated with the second metal ion. And the formation constant of this second metal ion with EDTA should be lower in comparison to your analyte metal ion with EDTA complex. That's all. Because when you will learn idiometric and idiometric titration, I think you have learned this. So in that case also you do back titration. So I think we have idiometry and idiometry also as well in this analytical reagents. So we'll cover this. So in back titration, a known excess of EDTA is added. The analyte, the excess EDTA will titrate it . So the second metal ion we were talking about, the second metal ion used in back titration must not displace . So this was about time is almost over about back titration. Next in the next class I will start with photometric titration. So what does this photometric refer to? Any idea?
Sunlight.
Photo means light, right? You measure the intensity of light. With the help of that, you proceed with the titration and how you are going to visually see the color change with the help of change in the light intensity. That I'll explain you in the next class.
Ma'am, can you please show the previous slide?
Previous slide? Yes, sure. So do you have your next class?
Ma'am, please show the first slide also.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. So this slide starts from 31 to 39. Not so many slides, but I think you understood whatever I taught. So in the next class, I'll finish the CDTA. There are 3 or 4 topics left. I'll finish the CDTA and in mein se koi bhi ek exam mein aane ki bahut zyada probability hoti hai. This is very important. And then we'll start discussing other analytical reagents. This topic is not very big, so I have to teach just one chapter. So sometimes I'll see if I get a chance, then I'll tell you how to draw chemical structures, how to write down chemical equations, or how do you write a simple equation like a Schrodinger wave equation. So I'll show you everything, how to draw a table. I think you all know how to draw a table, but still there are certain things that you need to know. So I'll keep one class for that. So that will definitely help you in future. Okay, any more questions? So your time is up. I'll see you in the next class.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.